You know, guys, I've been thinking about something lately. When you read the account, the historical account of Noah and the building of the ark lasted for about 100 years before it was finished. The Lord delayed the building of the ark for 100 years to give people the chance to repent and have everlasting life. Noah was also a preacher of righteousness. He was preaching about the Christ that would come and deliver us, and that we ought to place our trust in the finished work that will take place in the future. We today are looking back to what has been accomplished for us. We are walking in the fullness of the finished work, while those that lived before the cross had to look forward to what would come, and they didn't have the full package like we do today. But one thing I've noticed. The world's population was basically around at least 1 billion people at the time, maybe 2 billion, 4 billion, I don't know, but humanity, it was increased upon the earth. They were above 1 billion, okay? And besides that, you also had those Nephilim beings around there that also were in the millions. However, you had a human population of at least 1 billion at the time. And now the Lord decides that he's going to destroy all that lives upon the ground and to with a flood and to start over again through Noah and his family, because they're genetically they are purely human. There were also other human beings walking around that could have been saved, that could have believed the gospel. However, the Lord told Noah to build an ark. And you got to understand, the Lord didn't tell Noah to build a spaceship. He didn't tell him to build, how do I say it, a gigantic spacecraft that would contain thousands and thousands of people. No, the Lord told him to build an ark. And if you look carefully, 1 billion human beings, one boat, it was a large boat, let's be clear about that, but 1 billion people don't fit into a boat. You see, not even 1,000 people would fit into a boat like that. Okay, they would fit, but they also need space to live, to eat and drink and to poo and take a pee and everything. So, why did the Almighty told Noah to build a small ark and to place the safety of those that are saved in that ark, knowingly that it wouldn't have enough space to contain 1 billion people? Because listen to this, the Lord knew before the world began that those 1 billion human beings would rather, deny reality and live with darkness and sin in bondage, than that they would give up their self-entitlement and be saved by surrendering themselves to the Lord. So the Lord didn't waste any effort to, I would say it, to keep a safe place for people whom he already knew would never take a safe place anyway. See, sinners are proud, and especially psychopathic people are quite proud. They would rather be miserable and have everyone else around them miserable also, just like them, so that they can feel good about themselves. They'll rather reign in hell, in the lake of fire, where they are suffering for all eternity, than they would surrender themselves to the Lord and serve in the new heaven and new earth. So the Lord Jesus already knew that those people, those 1 billion people, it may have been 2 billion, but at least those 1 billion souls, that they did not want to repent, and they will search for excuses for all eternity to justify their sin, their rejection of God. That they didn't want to face the reality and acknowledge the Lord, his rightful place in their life. So, what did the Lord do? The Lord knew that there were a few people that would take the escape route. So, he made preparations for the remnant that did become saved. Understand me well, when the Lord Jesus later, like this, for about 2,000 years, 2,400 years after the flood, When the Lord Jesus went to the cross, he also took the place of that of those 1 billion people that perished during the great flood. However, when they were alive, they rejected the message that the Savior would come for them. So that's why when the Savior did arrive on earth, of course they were already dead, so they couldn't make a choice anymore. When the Savior did came to earth, the Savior took their place for them. However, they refused it beforehand. So yes, Jesus didn't die at the cross for nothing. He died for everyone. He brought salvation unto everyone. But not everyone wants to receive salvation. So listen to this carefully. The Lord made provision for salvation for everyone. However, not everyone is going to take the salvation. Some would rather perish in the flames of hell than to surrender their selfishness, to give up their selfishness, I mean. So in this life, the Lord will make provisions. I'm talking about this life now. Whether there are economic provisions, social provisions, sexual provisions, that concerns marriage and sexual relationships, spiritual, how do I say it, resources also. The Lord will make not only preparation, but he will secure in this life for solutions for those that become saved, for those that believe and obey the gospel. The remnant of humanity, God is looking after them. God is not looking after the majority, the mass that rejects him. He isn't. Because the big mass, today there are like 7 billion people living on this planet. All 7 billion people from this decade, they can all today become saved and receive everlasting life and complete deliverance and restoration and live in complete and absolute joy with each other in unity. It's possible. The Lord made all provisions at the cross. He also rose again, and he has preached the gospel through his people and through also sometimes also use angelic beings. He has preached his gospel to every nation, every tongue, and every kindred on earth. So everyone today can be saved. And it also was that way in the first century, shortly after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. However, just like in the days of Noah, the majority, the mass, decided to, you know, search for excuses, to search for, you know, accusations against the Lord. They were defending their selfishness and their abuse, even when they knew that it was abuse and that they would pay for it. They would rather pay for their abuse and keep the pride, that it's their decision that they decide, than to give themselves over to the Lord and have real life. Now listen, the Lord loves those people also, unconditionally, and he gave himself to them, but they refused to give in to his unconditional love. So that's why they will not receive his unconditional love. They will be excluded from the new heaven, new earth, and they will have to remain excluded from his joyful presence forever, and they will endure his wrath together with Satan and his fallen angels. Okay, it's completely just. Okay? And to make it clear again, in this life, when you're saved, when you're born again, the Lord is looking after you. For your sexual health, your mental health, your emotional health, your physical health, your economic well-being, the plans and dreams of your heart, God's looking after them also. The Lord is securing those that obey his gospel. Those that are saved, the Lord's looking after them. The Lord is rewarding his people, those that are in Christ Jesus, both Hebrews, black Hebrews, and the remnant of the Gentiles that believe in him. Not all Hebrews, only the black Hebrews that are in Christ, and the remnant of the heathen nations that also are born again. The Lord is looking after them. Those are his people, those are his bride, his partner, his wife, and he is rewarding them the good based upon the finished work of Christ. Okay? So the Lord is not looking after the majority of mankind that reject him and are pleased with unrighteousness. So it can be that the Lord places you in a difficult circumstance and that you will endure, for example, 200 stupid people that will treat you badly, but within those 200 people, three of them might later on repent from their heart and believe the gospel and be saved. So the Lord would allow you to endure 200 people who mistreat you to reach the three from the 200 that would repent. That's how you should look at your earthly circumstances, dear brothers and sisters in Christ. Don't look at the many people that reject you, treat you badly, and don't look at all the days that things seem to go wrong to you. You see, God has His way, and His ways are not ours, and His ways are better than ours. You see, the reason why I am saved also is because the Lord has made some Christians suffer ill treatment from others, and through, despite all the persecution, the message was also delivered unto me, and the Lord knew before time began that I would say yes, and the message came to me, I believed it, and I became saved. You see? And the Lord showed me this, that He will allow me to go through trouble, and He will use the trouble that people do to me to reach for the remnant that would say yes to the gospel. So yes, God has predestined certain people unto salvation, but not because He didn't want all others. He wanted all others, and He prepared everything and made everything ready for all of humanity. However, He knew that not all of humanity will take it, so the final, measurements He has taken for the well-being of the remnant. Okay? Just think about the Ark of Noah during that day. 1 billion people on the face of the earth, one boat that couldn't possibly maintain them all. And Noah was preaching the message of Christ to the people. So the people on earth then knew that, okay, that boat is big, but it can't contain the whole world. So not everyone can enter the boat. So most of us will never enter the boat, and most of us will perish. And the Lord told His servant Noah to build that boat that way, because the Lord knew that most of us would not want to repent anyway. So the Lord has given us that ark as a sign, as a testimony against our rebellion, and that our punishment is justified. That is, our punishment is just. So listen carefully. I've often wondered why the Lord doesn't give His servants, worldly power to dominate the earth and make all people believe. Satan does that. However, the Lord showed me that Satan is a loser, and that's why he needs to use intimidation and force to get what he wants, because, he's a loser. And the Lord showed me that, why waste giving us that are born again such a burden to influence and dominate mankind, when the most of them, the majority, still would not from their heart give themselves over to the Lord. They would rather give us the fault and blame us for everything that goes wrong with them, like they are doing right now. See, just like the Lord made the ark that small to only maintain and keep the remnant safe, so the Lord has made provisions and solutions today that are only effective to the remnant. You see, if you hear this message and you want to give your life to Christ and become saved to it today, now that you're hearing it, you're not sure if you will be alive tomorrow. It may be too late tomorrow, okay? Join the remnant and have everlasting life. And or be proud and perish and endure everlasting misery. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus, God Himself, be with you.